Hello and welcome to this special edition of Dateline, live from Paris. I'm Brett Mason. This city, this country, and indeed much of the world is coming to terms with the senseless violence that took place here last Friday night. The French government has declared war on Islamic State, and an international manhunt is now underway to capture the masterminds. Deuxième explosion, courez, courez!
J'ai perdu quelqu'un qui était avec moi au concert et c'est tout, je peux pas en dire.
On n'a pas peur, on n'a pas peur.
Nous sommes dans une guerre contre le terrorisme djihadiste qui menace le monde entier.
Vingt-trois individus ont été interpellés et placés en garde à vue.
Joining us live this evening is Jean-Charles Brassard, who is a security expert and actually advises governments on how to prepare for these acts of terror. The big question tonight is, how on earth were these attacks allowed to go undetected?
Look, the French intelligence services, as many others in Europe, are overwhelmed by the number of individuals being radicalized. We have currently 5,000 individuals on our watch list for security reasons. Then we have, in addition to that, 3,800 individuals that we suspect have been radicalized over the last 3 years. And in addition to that, again, 2,000 French citizens involved in the jihadi networks, whether in France or in Syria, among which 600 are currently fighting alongside the terrorist organizations there. So this is a first reason why today it's very difficult for the French intelligence, in general for European intelligence, to follow everybody and to put everybody under surveillance. This is just impossible. The second issue here is the lack of European coordination and exchange of information on a regular basis on these individuals, and the inability that we have to follow these, to trace these individuals when they travel, because there's no collective system of sharing of information in Europe.
And the other big challenge, aside from the sheer number of suspects that are under surveillance, is the way in which those potential militants communicate. That's changing, and that's a struggle for the intelligence community to keep up.
Of course, they're using more and more secrecy. We've seen that already with the Charlie bombing attacks, where several of them had several phones, were using encrypted devices. We suspect here that some of them could have used PSP devices to communicate between each other, because it's very hard for the intelligence to crack down these devices.
These are video games, and this is how jihadists are communicating. I mean, this is a brave new era. What do the intelligence services need to combat the sheer scale of the threat?
They absolutely need the collaboration of those of those who make those devices, Sony and others, because they cannot break these encrypted systems without their collaboration. It's just right impossible today.
So, given what you've just said, is it not impossible for the French government and other governments, including Australia, to stop future attacks exactly like this one happening in any city around the world?
Yes, we are facing the same problems. I mean, we are facing professionals who today know that we have increased our ability to get information about them, and so they will turn more and more increasingly to encryption and secrecy in the way they will conceive their terrorist plots.
Well, thank you very much, Jean-Charles Bernard, a counter-terrorism expert, giving us some insights into the scale of the challenge confronting Europe. Of course, the manhunt for those responsible extends much further than the French borders. In fact, much of the security services' attention is focused on Belgium and a small suburb just 4 kilometres from NATO headquarters. Molenbeek has a 40% youth unemployment rate and a dubious reputation for harbouring extremists.
Allahu Akbar! parce qu'il se faut endoctriner, c'est un lavage de cerveau. C'est exact, c'est juste, c'est le terme, il n'y a pas autre chose.
Armed police and explosive experts surround an apartment block in Brussels as the investigation into the Paris attacks continues to spread across Europe.
We've seen snipers on roofs and we've heard what sound like a number of explosions, but police aren't telling us exactly what's happening.
No one was arrested in the end. Police were looking for this man, Belgian-born Saleh Abdeslam, believed to be one of the attackers who fled Paris. Locals here who knew him were shocked.
Je tombe des nues parce que c'était un très gentil garçon.
One of his brothers was arrested but released by Belgian police today. I asked him what his message was to the families of the victims.
Sachez que voilà, moi et ma famille, nous sommes touchés par ce qui s'est passé. Nous avons appris ça par la télévision comme beaucoup d'entre vous et nous ne pensions à aucun moment que l'un de mes frères était lié à cet attentat.
Third brother, Brahim Abdeslam, is the only attacker to be identified from the group who launched repeated attacks on Paris bar and restaurant goers. The Stade de France suicide bombers included Bilal Hadfi, who had allegedly previously fought in Syria. Fellow bomber Ahmed Al-Mohammed arrived in Europe as a refugee on a possibly fake Syrian passport. Omar Ismail Mostafai from Paris attacked the Bataclan concert venue. So did fellow Parisian Sami Amemour. Both are now dead. Abaoud, the alleged mastermind in Syria, is one of Belgium's most notorious jihadis, who faked his own death to temporarily return to Europe. He even took his 13-year-old brother to ISIS with him. Neighbors at his father's house told us tonight the family were devastated. One described him as a normal weed-smoking young guy before he was radicalized.
There are more Belgian jihadis in Syria per capita than any other Western country, and a worrying number of them come from this fairly small but very multicultural Brussels district of Molenbeek. Now, a lot of the people here resent the association between them and terrorism, but the area has been linked to a whole series of attacks even long before all of this.
Last year, an attack on a Jewish museum in Brussels was carried out by a Frenchman who had spent time here. In January, police killed two men from Molenbeek in a shootout. They were suspected of plotting terrorist attacks in Belgium. And a foiled attack on a train from Amsterdam to Paris was also linked to the area. So what's going on in Molenbeek? Many say it's wrong to label Molenbeek a kind of jihadi capital, but it does have 40% youth unemployment, discrimination and crime. That makes people more vulnerable to radicalization.
They are a member of certain groups or gangs. They come in contact with certain radical elements that promise them many things, such as, well, atonement and forgiveness for everything they've done, and they promise them paradise.
Local young Muslims say they often felt harassed by the police, but were also horrified by the recent attacks.
Parce qu'il faut endoctriner, c'est un lavage de cerveau. C'est exact, c'est juste, c'est le terme. Il y a pas autre chose. Si on vient, on vous parle pendant des heures et des heures et des heures jusqu'à ce que vous acceptez la chose. Mais c'est pas ça l'islam.
What about the authorities here?
Moi, j'ai tiré la sonnette d'alarme en 2010.
I raised the alarm in 2010. I said there was a time bomb in the district. We've said for a long time that the problem is social order. So all we've needed to do is keep the young people occupied, make them play football, send them to the cinema. But we didn't help them find a place in society.
Horrific violence always leaves the question why. For 129 victims, though, the answers are too late.
As you can see from these live pictures, hundreds are still turning out to place flowers in memory of all of those who have lost their lives here. A huge police presence remains on the streets. The French president has declared war with Islamic State, but as we heard, the challenge is a huge one.